We turn now to the second of our five hermeneutical principles, and again, the first one, remember, was a bit of a presupposition that undergirded the rest of the categories. It was also more of a subjective category. Now, in number two, we turn to a more traditional objective category, as we do for the remaining ones that we will cover as well. And the second hermeneutical principle can be called the grammatical element, the grammatical element. And one way to explain this, I guess, is to suggest to you my thesis, and that is this. Every translation involves interpretation. Every translation involves interpretation. In other words, you can't perfectly go from one language to another in a completely neutral fashion. You'll always either lose something or you'll somehow distort something in the translation process. I have a colleague at another seminary who has a saying. It's a little bit different, but it makes the same point. It goes like this. Every translation is a commentary in disguise. Every translation is a commentary in disguise. A commentary, of course, is that verse-by-verse explanation of the biblical text. And that saying says that every translation, it may not look like it, it may look like an innocent, neutral thing, but wait a minute, there's actually a commentary, not just a translation, at work in this process. Let me illustrate that to you in a very simple way, I hope, from my own particular background. You may have watched the introductory video in which I talked about my Dutch heritage. I showed those wooden shoes. And so there's a Dutch word that I'd like to talk to you about in order to illustrate this thesis. Every translation involves interpretation. And the Dutch word is gezellig. You have to have a lot of spit in your mouth when you say that word, gezellig. And I wonder if you've heard that word before, and if you haven't, and you probably haven't, how can I get you to understand what that word means? I mean, I could translate it for you, but, you know, you'd lose a lot. Instead, I'd have to get you to better close your eyes, just for a little while, not too long. And I want you to imagine a cold winter's day. The snow is blowing, the wind is howling, the temperature is freezing cold, but the good news is you're at home. And you're in your favorite room, we'll call it the den, and there's a fireplace going. Can you feel the warmth of the rays of the flames coming on your body? And of course, you're not alone. You've got all your family and your friends. Anybody who's near and dear to you is gathered around. And of course, there's a cup of coffee in your hand. And you're sitting in your easy boy chair. And then you have to take a deep, kind of cleansing, therapeutic breath. And I could say, that's gezellig. I mean, I could have translated it for you and simply said the word means warm, cozy. But you know, those English words are kind of wimpy translations. They really fail to capture the force, the meaning of that one Dutch word, gezellig. It's a rich term, full of meaning, full of great love for those who are familiar with the term. Well, in a similar way, when you go from the Greek of the New Testament or the Hebrew of the Old Testament to English translation, you lose something. You know, we sometimes need a lot of words in English to somehow convey whatever the original Greek or original Hebrew might have originally said. There are a bunch of sayings that I've collected that highlight this important business of grammar and the translation process. The Italians have a proverb that goes like this, traduttore traduttora, which means the translator is a traitor. It's not a very happy saying, of course, if you're in the translation business, but it's meant to capture the idea that, well, no matter how gifted the translator may be, no matter how hardworking the translator may be, he or she ultimately betrays the original text. The Swedish Bible Translation Committee had a statement in their preface when it first came out that I found kind of striking. Now, you have to imagine here a bunch of Swedish biblical scholars. They spent many years. They're very gifted. They've been working to put together this Swedish translation. And after all of their years of hard work and despite all of their abilities, they have a concession in the foreword of their translation. And their concession is, the art of translation is the art of compromise. You know what compromise means, don't you? You have a husband and wife going through a difficult time in their marriage, and the counselor might say, oh, you guys have to compromise. You have to give up something in order for the two to become one and to have a happy relationship. And I find it kind of interesting, sobering, that this Swedish Bible Translation Committee says, you know, what we're giving to you, despite all our years of effort and ability, is really a compromise. We had to give up some things as we presented to you this translation. Remember my thesis, every translation involves interpretation to some degree. A Jewish poet once said this, reading the Bible in translation is like kissing your bride through a veil. Now you can do that. I mean, you can kiss your beloved on the wedding day through a veil, but you know, somehow it loses the intimacy. Somehow it's not quite as sweet as the real thing, as a direct kiss on the lips. And in a similar way, you can read the Bible with profit in English, or whatever your native language may be. I want to stress that. You can read the Bible with profit in your own translation, whatever that may be. But having said that, even though you can do that with profit, you nevertheless still lose something. In a certain sense, you're distant from the text. I found another saying from a classical scholar. And you have to realize that this is a scholar who makes his living translating. His primary job is to translate Latin text into English. And yet he soberingly says, translation is sin, right? Despite his hard work, he recognizes that he's doing something bad by rendering the original Latin in an English translation. Now, let me give you an example. Of course, there are so many that you could pick from almost any passage of Scripture. You can illustrate the grammatical principle, the idea that you have to take seriously the original language, right? That's part of the interpretation process. But I'm picking out, I've got about five of them in a row here of different types, that just to give you as a point of illustration. The first one comes from the Gospel of Luke 5-8. It's the parable of the friend at midnight, and it goes like this, in case you can't remember it. Then Jesus said to them, suppose one of you has a friend, and he goes to him at midnight and says, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, because a friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. Then the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is already locked, and my children are with me in bed. I can't get up and give you anything. I tell you, though he will not get up and give him the bread because he is his friend, yet because of the man's I don't want to translate it, because remember, as soon as I translate this word, I don't just translate it, I interpret it. Because of the man's the Greek word, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. Now, let me give you a bit of backdrop before we look at specifically the grammatical illustration at hand. The parable is a parable about prayer. You say, no, it's not. The word prayer isn't found anywhere in the parable. I say, yes, it is, because of its context. That's another important hermeneutical principle. Every passage ought to be understood in its context. And you can go back and you can see that this passage comes from Luke 11, verse 5. But if you go to Luke 11, verse 1, you'll read, one day Jesus was praying. So Jesus was praying. And as soon as he said amen, the disciples said, Master, teach us how to pray. And then we find the words of what we commonly refer to as the Lord's Prayer. And then right after that comes the parable of the friend at midnight. And this parable comes now, not by accident or fluke chance. No, Jesus had been praying. They said, Master, teach us how to pray. And so Jesus continued to give them further instruction about prayer by telling them this parable, the parable of the friend at midnight. So everybody, all commentators agree that this is a parable about prayer. That's not the issue at hand. What is the issue is, what is it teaching us about prayer specifically? And the answer clearly is found in verse 8, where Jesus finishes the parable, the story proper, and then he gives the application. Again, Jesus says, I tell you, though he will not get up and give him the bread because he is his friend, yet because of the man's, and then in Greek it says, anaideon, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. Now, this Greek word anaideon occurs only one time in the whole New Testament, so we can't just go to other places and see how the word is used there. So I guess we'll have to go then not other places in the New Testament, then we go to the Old Testament, it's not found there. Then we go outside the Bible into secular Greek. And there we have a little bit of a problem, because the Greek word anaideon has at least two different meanings. One meaning, you can see, is the meaning boldness. And actually, boldness fits the context of the parable relatively well. Remember, this guy had an unexpected guest come at midnight. And then he goes to his neighbor at midnight. Now, I have a good relationship with my neighbor. I'm not afraid to ask him for almost anything. But, you know, if it's midnight, I'm a little bit hesitant. You have to be bold. You have to have a little bit of chutzpah, so to say, in order to go to your neighbor in the middle of the night and ask him this. And if that's the context of the parable, if that's the meaning that Jesus intended, then he's teaching us to be bold in prayer. Just like the man was bold and that resulted in the answering of his request, so also we in our prayer life need to be bold and that will result in the answering of our request. In other words, even though God is great and we are small, we ought not to be shy, we ought not to be reticent, but to quote another biblical author, we ought to boldly approach the throne of grace. That's one possible meaning of this word and thereby interpretation of this parable. However, anaideion can mean also something else. You're not surprised, of course, that words can mean more than one thing. Even in English, right, we have that. You take the word hot, for example. If you are watching this video and you say, you know, someone else watches this video and you meet that person, you say, "Oh, Wima was hot today." Well, what does that mean? Well, it could mean different things. It could mean that I'm sweating profusely. That's one meaning of the word hot. It could be that I got angry for whatever reason. I blew my top. I was hot. Or maybe you like my pink shirt and you say, "Oh, Wima was hot today." You see, the word hot can have multiple meanings. You can only decide it by its context. So it shouldn't be surprising to us that Greek words too can have multiple meanings. And they have to be determined by its context. So the Greek word anaideion means more than one thing. It can mean boldness, but it can also mean persistence. Now, persistence isn't the same as boldness. To be persistent means to do something, and then if you're not successful, you keep on doing it over and over again until you finally succeed. You don't give up. And that, too, fits the context of this parable. Remember, when he first knocked on the door, the answer at first was, "Hey, don't bother me. The door is already locked and my children are with me in bed." Just to pick up a bit of historical context, you know, we have to imagine a first century Jewish home of peasant people, basically a very simple building with maybe one room dividing the animals on one side and the whole family sleeping together on the other side. And so, obviously, in this kind of historical context, it'd be impossible to get up without getting the whole house all stirred. But then we read at the end of the parable, the man gets up and gives him as much as he needs. So even though the answer was no at first, he must not have given up. He must have been persistent because he ultimately went home and went home with his requested food. And so this too also will fit not just this context, but larger teaching of Luke. Because Luke has another parable in Luke 18 about the persistent widow who goes to the secular judge and she keeps bugging the judge, keeps hounding the judge, and finally he says, "You know, oh, I don't care about God or people, but yet this woman, you know, keeps hounding me," and so he answers her request. And Jesus prefaces that story by saying he told this story to his disciples so they would always pray and never give up. In other words, that's a teaching of Luke to be persistent in prayer. Now, which one is the right one? Well, at this stage, I'm going to leave you hanging, I'm afraid, and not tell you what I think is the right one, because that's not the point I want to make. At this point, I simply want you to see how different the interpretation of the parable is, depending on what translation you give to the Greek word anaideion. A translator comes to the Greek word and they have to make a choice. How do I translate this word? Do I translate it as boldness? So that's a teaching about being bold in prayer. Or do I translate it as persistence? So it's a teaching about being persistent in prayer. The translator has to pick. As I said, my thesis is every translation to some degree involves interpretation. Here's a second example, a little shorter one that we can cover. It comes actually right after the parable we looked at. These words, I think, are familiar to many of us. Jesus says, "So I say to you, ask, it will be given to you, seek, and you will find, knock, and the door will be opened to you." Now, this is not so much a question of the meaning of verbs, the meaning of the words used, but maybe the nuance of these words. Those verbs are actually commands. They're imperatives. Ask, seek, knock. We could put an exclamation mark. Those are commands. And in the Greek language, there are two different ways that you can give a command. You can give one way using what we call aorist imperatives. I won't have to explain what that all is. Let me just say that it means it's an unemphatic or unstressed, unemphasized way of commanding. It doesn't mean that you think it's unimportant. It just means you're not stressing it. You're not emphasizing it. However, a rarer form is this present imperative, where it has the idea of an ongoing or continuous action. And each of these three commands in this verse are given in that rarer, more emphatic, ongoing, continuous action sense form. So actually, instead of translating it, ask, it'll be given to you, I could, with some justification, translate it, keep on asking, or maybe ask persistently, and it'll be given to you. And the next one, seek, not just seek, but keep on seeking, or seek persistently, and you will find. And not just knock, but keep on knocking, or knock persistently, and the door will be open to you. You see, the Greek text tells us more in a richer way than what the English translation does. Here's a third example from Colossians 2, verse 18. Paul is writing to the church of Colossae in modern-day Turkey, ancient Asia Minor, and there was some problem that he was identifying. Scholars are a little bit perplexed as to exactly how defined this problem is, but somehow the readers were doing something that Paul rebukes, and he says in the middle of that, don't let anyone who delights in false humility, and then this phrase, the worship of angels, disqualify you for the prize. So Paul is saying there are some people over there in Colossae who are involved in the worship of angels, the worship of angels. Now actually, what does that mean, the worship of angels? There are two possibilities. Each of them are equally possible from a grammatical point of view. I don't know what you're thinking of. I imagine the way that most people would hear this is, when they hear the phrase worship of angels, they're thinking about humans now who are worshiping angels. In other words, these are people who, instead of directing their praise and their worship to God, are directing it toward angels. They're involved in the worship of angels. And that's one possible way to render the grammar of this Greek phrase. But an equally possible alternative, it's just as possible, is to have this phrase refer to the worship that angels themselves do. That's a different meaning. Not people who are worshiping angels, but we're talking about the worship that angels themselves are engaged in. Especially if Paul has a Jewish context in mind. The Jews believe that their worship in the earthly temple was simply a mirror reflection of what was happening in heaven in the heavenly temple. And maybe Paul is talking about Jews, or maybe Jewish Christians, but people who somehow think that they have a vision into the heavenly realms where they can watch angels worship. Or maybe Paul has in view the idea that these are people who think that they participate. Their worship is some kind of sharing in the worship that angels do. And again, at this stage, I'm not really interested in suggesting to which one is the right one. I simply want this to be another example of how every translation involves interpretation. How you interpret what Paul is talking about and addressing to the Colossians is impacted by the grammar of the text, the meaning of not so much words, but the connection, the relationship, the grammatical relationship of these words. Well, maybe you think this is something, this grammatical element is only for a select group of people like me, us egghead Greek geek types. But I want to suggest to you that's not the case. Sometimes there are very big, important texts on which the church has huge issues about, which are partly dependent on grammatical considerations. For example, here's a controversial text from 1 Timothy 2, verse 12. Now, most translations, you can see the NIV, the most popular English translation around today, render it something like this. I permit no woman to teach or to have authority over men. So if you're involved in a church that's examining the question of women's ordination, whether we should have women pastors or elders or deacons, well, obviously, this is an important verse that you'll have to wrestle with. And part of properly interpreting this verse, not the only thing, there's a lot more to our hermeneutic that we have to talk about yet in subsequent sessions, but part of the answer, an important part of the answer, is grammar kind of questions. For example, one kind of grammar question is, what is the meaning of that word? You can see it there in Greek, authentein, authentein. Now, it's true that its most common meaning is to have authority. But again, this is like the word we saw in the parable. This is a word that occurs only here in the whole Bible. It occurs nowhere else. And when you go outside the Bible, the word authentein does have some other possible meanings. And so, does Paul have those other meanings in mind, or is he really talking about women not having authority? That's a question you have to ask and hopefully answer. Or here's not so much a question of the meaning of the word, but the relationship of some words. You can see here that Paul permits actually a woman, he mentions two things, to teach and to have authority. Now, what's the relationship between these two, we call them infinitives, to teach or to have authority? I mean, one idea could be that Paul has two separate ideas here. Paul comes along and says, I forbid women to do two things, namely one, to teach, right, and two, to have authority. Those are two separate ideas. However, it's equally possible from a grammatical point of view that the second infinitive is meant to clarify the first infinitive. In other words, when Paul says to teach, he doesn't mean just any old kind of teaching, but a very specific kind of teaching, a teaching in which a woman has authority or proclaims herself to have authority. Somehow these two are brought together. Or more technically, the second infinitive acts like an adverb modifying the first infinitive. Now again, stop trying to figure out whether I'm for women in office or against women in office. You're missing the point of the illustration, right? The illustration here is instead to show you that grammatical considerations are of great, great importance to interpretation. And what's more, they're a necessary part of interpretation. If I, as a pastor, am trying to explain this verse and I start talking about the meaning of the verb authentein, and I start talking about the meaning of the grammatical construction between these two infinitives, to teach and to have authority, that's not because I'm liberal, that's not a bad thing, that's actually a necessary thing. That's a good part of a reformed hermeneutic. That's a proper way to handle the scriptures. Now, I don't want you to be so scared of your translation that you throw it away. I mean, that would be overstating the case. Most translations, well, virtually all translations, are done with great, great care. They're done usually by a team of scholars to stop one person from having an undue bias in terms of the translation. And they're usually done by careful scholars and Bible-believing Christians, and so it's not as if we shouldn't trust our English translation. But yet on the other hand, there is a healthy sense in which we ought to ask ourselves regularly, now this may be what my Bible says, but is that actually what the Bible originally stated? In other words, maybe if I knew something about the original Greek or Hebrew, maybe that would shed light on the meaning of a particular passage. In other words, whether you learn the Greek language or not, whether you become like me, a Greek geek, or you don't, it doesn't matter. All of us have to have room in our interpretation for the Bible of our second hermeneutical principle, namely this grammatical element. I mean, of course, ideally, it'd be great if we knew the Greek well enough we could do it ourselves. But, you know, not many of us have the time or the ability, you know, to develop our Greek skills at that level. And that's why it's important to surround ourselves not just with a cloud of witnesses, I'm talking about secondary sources, other scholars who have analyzed these kind of things, but I have to say a good cloud of witnesses. I have to stress that because there's too much information almost available nowadays. You shouldn't trust anything you find on the internet. You have to kind of discern what are good, reliable secondary sources, the kind of voices who can help you answer these kind of questions. In other words, don't be the kind of person who says, I don't know Greek, you know, therefore I just forget about this. And also, don't think about this as some way to get around what the translations say. Let me give you a personal example of this wrong attitude. A number of years ago, I was serving as an interim pastor in a church, And it was time for us to elect officers, elders and deacons. And so for week one, I had a sermon on elders, trying to help people as we nominated and voted for elders to do so in a fitting fashion. I talked about elders, their qualifications, their task, and their reward. And then it came to the next week, and I thought, well, we've got to be fair. We've got to have something for deacons. And so I also had a sermon on deacons, and I looked at every passage in the Bible that talks about deacons. Actually, there aren't as many as you might think. So it wasn't as if I cherry-picked, as if I deliberately ignored one or two. I was selective in my choices. No, I looked at all the texts that possibly could talk about deacons. And as a result of that, I stumbled across Romans 16:1-2. Romans 16:1-2. And if you look up Romans 16:1-2, you'll see there a reference to a woman by the name of Phoebe, who is a something of the Church of Kenchrea. Now, in the NIV, which was the Bible that we had in the pew in this particular church where I was preaching, it said, Phoebe, who is a servant of the Church of Kenchrea. And so I read the text and had people look up the text in their Bible, and I said to them, the Greek word used here is diakonos, right? And one meaning of the Greek word diakonos is servant. And that's why the NIV has translated the way we find in our pew Bible today, Phoebe, who is a servant of the Church of Kenchrea. But even if you don't know Greek, you can hear the Greek word diakonos could also be translated the word deacon. So another possible translation is Phoebe, who is a deacon or deaconess of the Church of Kenchrea. Well, there was a member of the church who was not there that night and was apparently upset with me and came over the next day. And now listen to the logic of this person. It's a faulty logic. It's the logic I'm trying to avoid by giving you this example. He said something like this to me. He was upset with me. He said, the Bible says, notice he says the Bible says she is a servant, and you have no business saying that she is anything else. I hope you see the wrong logic of his thinking. The Bible doesn't say servant. I mean, literally, actually, the Bible says diakonos, right? That's the inspired word that Paul, by the leading of the Spirit, was given, and he wrote to the Romans. The Bible says diakonos. And diakonos can mean servant. That's a possible meaning of the word, but it can also mean deacon. And again, we can debate which one is more likely in this case, but that's not the point of the illustration. The point of the illustration is, again, grammar makes a difference. Or in terms of my thesis, every translation involves, to some degree, interpretation. And so again, dear friends, if you have the opportunity to ground yourself in the languages, go for it. What a blessing to be able to read and handle the text in its original languages, Hebrew and Greek. But even if you can't, remember, you can't ignore this second hermeneutical principle. You need to surround yourself with a good cloud of witnesses, those books or those scholars who do know the language and who can offer you insights into the meaning of the biblical text. Well, that's it then for our second hermeneutical principle, the grammatical element.